Diabetic nephropathy refers to the kidney damage caused by both type 1 and type 2 diabetes. Because of the growing number of people affected by diabetes, diabetic nephropathy is currently the leading cause of end-stage renal disease in most developed countries around the world. Each kidney has millions of nephrons, each of which is served by a tiny capillary bed called a glomerulus. The tiny arteriole that approaches the glomerulus is called the afferent arteriole, A for approaching, and the arteriole that exits the glomerulus is called the efferent arteriole, E for exits. The glomeruli are a tiny cluster of capillaries that are physically supported by mesangial cells. So when blood is filtered, it moves through the endothelium lining the capillary, then through the basement membrane, and then through the epithelium lining the nephron, and finally into the nephron itself, at which point it's called filtrate. Now, the endothelium has pores that keep cells from entering the filtrate, and the basement membrane is negatively charged and repels other negatively charged molecules and proteins, like the protein albumin. Furthermore, the epithelium has a special cell type called a podocyte, which looks like an octopus because it has foot processes that wrap around the basement membrane, which leaves tiny gaps between its octopus-like projections called filtration slits. In diabetes mellitus, there's an excess of glucose in the blood, because it can't get into cells. And when blood gets filtered through the kidneys, some of that excess glucose starts to spill into the urine, called glycosuria. In addition, when there's a lot of glucose in the blood, it also starts sticking to proteins in the blood, a process called non-enzymatic glycation, because no enzymes are involved. Because glucose can get through the endothelium, this process of glycation can also involve the basement membrane of small blood vessels, which makes it thicken. The process particularly affects the efferent arteriole, causing it to get stiff and more narrow, a process called hyaline arteriosclerosis. This creates an obstruction that makes it difficult for blood to leave the glomerulus, which increases pressure within that glomerulus. At the same time, the afferent arteriole dilates, which allows more blood flow into the glomerulus and increases pressure even more. High pressure in the glomerulus leads to an increase in the glomerular filtration rate, which is just the amount of blood filtered through per minute. And this is the first stage of diabetic nephropathy, called hyperfiltration. In response to this high pressure state, the supportive mesangial cells secrete more and more structural matrix, which expands the size of the glomerulus. This matrix deposition and mesangial expansion can happen uniformly, or it can result in little nodules within the mesangium, called Kimmelstiel-Wilson nodules, which are tiny balls of protein. The thickening of the basement membrane counterintuitively makes it more permeable, allowing proteins like albumin through that otherwise would have been filtered out. It makes sense though if you think about our octopus friend again. As the glomerulus expands, the legs of the octopus naturally have larger gaps between them. In other words, the filtration slits widen, making it easier for substances to slip through. So in the end, the key abnormalities in diabetic nephropathy are a thickened glomerular basement membrane, mesangial expansion, Kimmelstiel-Wilson nodules, and disruption of the podocytes. Eventually, these changes damage the glomerulus so much that it's unable to filter blood normally, and the glomerular filtration rate decreases. Typically, diabetic nephropathy starts quietly, with no symptoms during the hyperfiltration phase. But over time, as more and more of the nephrons are affected, the kidney becomes less and less effective at filtering the blood into the urine, and the glomerular filtration rate decreases dramatically. Once the kidneys no longer can do their job of filtering the blood, a person enters into end-stage renal disease. Because there are no overt symptoms of diabetic nephropathy, regularly screening the urine of individuals with diabetes is super important. Microalbuminuria, which means excreting 30 to 300 milligrams of albumin in a day, is a reliable signal that diabetic nephropathy has started to set in. Excreting above 300 milligrams per day is considered macroalbuminuria, and is a sure sign of a problem. Unfortunately, diabetic nephropathy is a progressive complication that can be significantly slowed down, but not completely stopped. Keeping tight control on hypertension and hyperglycemia is critical. Specifically, angiotensin-converting enzyme inhibitors, or ACE inhibitors, as well as angiotensin receptor blockers can be particularly useful. These not only lower blood pressure as a whole, but they also specifically reduce constriction of the efferent arteriole. By reducing this constriction, we reduce the pressure within the glomerulus, as well as the damage that comes from it. All right, as a quick recap, diabetic nephropathy is kidney damage that's caused by diabetes, which results in glomerular basement membrane thickening, mesangial expansion, and sclerosis. An initial phase of increased glomerular filtration rate is followed by progressive albuminuria, then a gradual decline in glomerular filtration rate, and finally renal failure. This progression can be slowed by tight control of blood sugar and blood pressure, and the use of ACE inhibitors or angiotensin receptor blockers to decrease pressure specifically within the glomerulus.
Hey everybody, my name is Kyle. I'm one of the team members here at Osmosis. I do a little bit of everything for content, so I've done a little bit of script writing, I've done some voiceovers, I've done some video editing, reviewed some of the videos too, but mostly I'm a project manager, so I help make sure that the whole bus doesn't go flying off the road. And I do work on our internationalization. So if you've been noticing, there's a lot of foreign language translations. That's thanks to Translators Without Borders and a lot of people like you on YouTube who have come in to just to try and help get our videos out to as many people as possible in different languages. So thanks for all your hard work. That's really meant a lot to us. I want to just give a quick shout out to Krista Morris, who wrote the script for this video. And of course, Rishi for reviewing it and editing it, and Tanner for doing the illustrations. Also, don't forget to check out, I think on our social media, we have Instagram, we have Facebook, we have Twitter. We have a new Reddit channel that you can go and start having conversations. We post all of our new videos there. And then, don't forget to check us out on Patreon and consider donating to help us make more videos. Thanks so much.